Welcome to H2K Infosys. H2K Infosys is an e-verify business based in Atlanta, Georgia, United States. We provide 100% job-oriented, instructor-led, face-to-face, true live online software training programs. It also includes access to cloud test lab with software tools. We provide live project for you to work on. We also provide assistance with mock interviews, resume preparation and review, and job placement assistance. H2K Infosys is trusted by so many students across the world. H2K Infosys provides world-class services in IT training with real-time project work for corporates and individuals, special IT training for MS students in the United States, software design, development, QA manual and automation, performance testing and maintenance, IT staff augmentation, job placement assistance and tech support.
So our H2K Infosys is located in different locations all over the world.
I can hear you probably. Can you speak a little bit louder, please?
Yeah, Sandeep. Is it okay now? Sandeep?
Okay, but it's still a little bit low, okay? Because whenever you speak, it's little
can you increase the volume of your headset, please?
I think my volume is full.
All right. So H2K Infosys provides lots of services here, maybe IT trainings, real-time project works, corporates, and also individual trainings. So special IT trainings for MS students, software design development, and regarding testing, maybe manual or automation performance, lots of, okay, IT staff, augmentation, placement assistance, technical support, so on. Anyway, we are going to discuss now regarding Java. See, coming to Java here, it is mainly developed by a person called as James Gosling. James Gosling is the main person, and his team members are Patrick Gatton, Chris Arth, Ed Prank, and Mike Sheldon. All these people are team members of James Gosling, and all these people together, being together, they have developed our Java software at Sun Microsystems. Now, Java or Sun Microsystems is acquired by Oracle Corporation, but earlier it is developed at Sun Microsystems. It is basically developed for the purpose of electronics and internet programming, for the purpose of home level appliances. See, maybe for the purpose of or microwaves or washing machine. So on any kind of hardware device, we are able to execute our Java program. That's the main reason it is introduced earlier. And it is introduced in the year 1995, and it is named as OAK. Right, but here, by the time they want to register it, already somebody has chosen name OAK and it is no more available. So they have renamed it as Java and they have standardized the language, right? And Java is one of the object-oriented programming language. So once you learn object-oriented programming language, see, not only Java, we have lots of other object-oriented programming languages. Maybe .NET, maybe C++, so on. There are lots of object-oriented programming languages. More or less here, all these object-oriented programming languages will be same. Java is very simple. All majority of syntaxes are, all the basic syntaxes are retrieved from basic languages of C and C++. So the people who knows C and C++ as your any common language as they have extracted these common syntax from basic languages here, we can feel more comfortable and more simple, robust, error free. Here it provides a concept called as exception handling. So by making use of exception handling, we will be able to handle any kind of exception at runtime of program. So at the time of execution of our application, whatever problem arises, we will be able to handle the problem with the help of exception handling. So we can say it as robust application. Architectural neutral. So we are able to execute our Java program on any kind of architecture. So our window, our machine may have any kind of architecture. Without bothering about hardware components, on any kind of hardware machine, we are able to execute our Java program successfully. So we are saying it as architectural neutral. Next, platform independent. It is possible through JVM. How come it is possible? Simply here, platform independent indicates that here our Java applications are operating system independent. So whatever the operating system we use, it may be Windows, Linux, Linux, Mac, whatever the operating system you want, you can use, and we will be able to execute the same Java application successfully without any mistakes. All right. And here, it is possible to be done by making use of JVM, Java Virtual Machine. All right. How it works, we will see later with a detailed diagram. Okay. So we can understand that our Java program is hardware independent and also software independent. So we are able to execute our Java program on any kind of machine. In the same way here, we are also able to execute our Java program on any kind of operating system, no problem at all. Understand? Now we will see features of object oriented programming language. See here, OOPS stands for object oriented programming. See, class. What is a class? 1 minute, please. So better all of you mute your mic. So whenever you have any queries to ask me, you can unmute your mic and you can ask me, or else you can chat with me through chat window. All right. Thank you all. Come on, Zina. See here. What is a class? See, class is one of the generic representation. Example, you can say fruit as a class, and there are lots of fruits. Example, banana, orange, apple. All these are examples of the class fruit. Okay, so what is a class? A class is a generic representation. A class may have properties, it may have functionalities, what we call as methods in Java. See here, let's say a class human being. So if at all we take up a class human being, for our class human being, we can have properties. Example, see here, here we can have some properties like height, weight, color, so on.
Well, hey, right. Hello.
Yeah.
Hi, this is Bhoj.
Yeah, Bhoj, speak out, please.
Yes, sorry, I got a little bit late running. So how are you guys doing?
Yeah, just now we have started. Nothing to worry.
Okay, great. How many people are in the session?
Yeah.
How many people are in the session?
Maybe something like 7 members, including you.
Oh, great. Okay, thank you.
Excuse me. See now here. So, class. See here. Class is a generic representation. Can you mute your mic, Bhoj? Right. See now here. See here, class. A class is a generic representation. See, example, our class human being. So, in a class human being, we may have some properties. Example, height, color, weight. We can say the mass properties of a class human being. In the same way here, a class may also have methods, that is functionalities. Example, see, a human being can eat, a human being can walk, a human being can listen, then we can talk, then we can run, then we can dance. So we can say all these are functionalities of a class human being. So according to Java terminology, we call them as methods. We won't call them as functionalities, we call them as methods. Okay. So instead of methods, in each and every method we will have respective functionality. Understand? So here, we can say class as a generic representation. Next we have object. What is object here? An object is an instance of a class. Object is an instance of a class. Example here, for a class human being, we can say we all are objects. You are one object, I am another object, so on. We all are objects of a class human being. Understand? Come on, next. Encapsulation. What is this encapsulation? See here. You might have seen some capsules, right? See here. But I've seen like some capsules like this, right? So whenever we open a capsule here, what do you feel here? See? It will be like this here. Whenever we open a capsule here, internet contains lots of bubbles, right? Internet contains lots of bubbles. Right. Simply multiple bubbles will be there like this, right? So like you have a chance to have lots of bubbles as a part of a capsule, right? Like a medicine will be having capsule, right? So in general, as a part of a capsule, you have a lot of bubbles, right? So the same way here, what is encapsulation Java? What is this encapsulation? So, see, in our class, let's say in our example of a class human being, but again, we are having both properties as well as functionalities in a single unit. Example, in our class human being, we have properties like height, color, weight, width, so on. We can say them as properties. Same way here, we also have functionalities. Example, eat, listen, walk, run, drink, dance. We can say all of them are as functionalities, right? So encapsulation of both properties and also functionalities into a single unit is what called as encapsulation, right? So now here, with the help of encapsulation, we are able to wrap up all properties and functionalities together to be a single unit. Understand? With the help of encapsulation, we can wrap up all properties and functionalities of a class into a single unit. Okay, that's what the purpose of encapsulation. Next, abstraction. Abstraction indicates hiding all the inner details. Okay, abstraction indicates hiding all the inner level details. So here, by making use of abstraction, we are able to hide all the inner level details. Example, see, to drive a car, we need not know what is internal mechanism of the car. Simply here, we have proper user interface for a car to drive a car. So here, simply, we need to know how to drive the car, but we need not know internal mechanism, how the car is working, right? Because here, they are hiding all the inner level details through abstraction. Abstraction indicates hiding all the inner level details. See? Let's say any person, maybe a doctor or a lawyer, anybody may go to ATM, or a student may go to ATM, and simply they will have a beautiful UI user interface. So they can do, they may draw money, or they may transfer funds, or they may check balance, whatever they want they can do. But do they know what is internal mechanism? No, they do not know anything. Simply they are after all end users. So simply here, they need not know what is happening internally, right? they need not know what's happening internally, right? Same way here also here. We need not know what's happening. We need not make our end user to know all the inner level details. Whatever is required by end user, we should make only those things to be known by end user, and we can hide all the unnecessary stuff. Alright. And next here, see here, inheritance. See now here. Inheritance. See, acquiring features from one class to another class is what called as inheritance. Example, see now, see here we have inherited our features from our parents, right? So simply here, along with the, we have some of the features of parents. Addition to the features of our parents, we may also have our own behavior, right? So along with features of our parents, we are also having lots of our own features, right? In the same way here, let's say here we have a car class. Let's say here we have a class called as car, okay? Let's say it is a car called as BMW, okay? BMW car. So our BMW car may go for inheritance of car class, right? So let's say it is a car class. So let's say it is BMW car. So it is BMW car, okay? So now our BMW car is inheriting the class called as car, okay? So what's happening now here? BMW car is having all the features of a car, and BMW car also has its own features, right? And BMW car also has its own features. So here what are the common functionalities are there in car? We need not write those common functionalities once again inside this BMW car. As already we have these functionalities inside the car class, simply now our BMW car class will inherit the features of car class. Once again, we need not write all those inner level details. Okay, see now here. So next thing is here, inheritance. So here one class is able to inherit features of another class. So here we need not to go over rewriting the same functionalities again and again. We can eliminate wastage of time with the help of reusability. Clear now? Next, see now here. See here, it is polymorphism. What is polymorphism? Poly means many. Formism means forms, many forms. So simply here, see, the same person may behave differently in different situations, right? So we can say it as polymorphism, right? So while we are with our parents, we may behave in one way. When we are with our friends, we behave differently. Same way, when we are working in a company, we do behave differently, so on. It all depends upon situation, right? So moment to moment, our behavior may be different. All right, so polymorphism, many forms. So here, the same way here also, we can make our Java program to work on many forms, right? Next one is here, dynamic binding. Runtime polymorphism is what called as dynamic binding, right? Runtime polymorphism is called as dynamic binding. Okay, so we'll see now working this dynamic binding. Come on, see here, at runtime of program, we are able to change functionality of Java code. Okay, so the same code, Java code, but at runtime of program, we are able to change its functionality. Understand? So the same Java code may behave differently according to situations here. That is what is called as dynamic binding. Our dynamic binding is also called as runtime polymorphism, or it is also called as dynamic method dispatch. Okay. Next. See now here, message passing. See, one object is able to communicate with another object. Let's say, for example, here we all are human beings. So We all are objects of a class human being. So an object is able to communicate with another object. So I am talking to you now and you can also talk to me. So here you can say that one object is able to communicate with another object. In the same way here also, as a part of our programming, we can make a program to communicate with another program, right? We can make one Java class object to communicate with another Java or class object. Clear now? Right, come on. Next. See now here. So, multi-threading. So, as a part of a program here, whenever you want to achieve multi-threading, we can go for that. Why do we require multi-threading? See here, example. So, here, sometimes you have to execute multiple tasks at a time, right? Example, see, right now we are watching screen and we are also listening to audio. So right now we are doing two works at a time, right? One is video, another one is audio. The same way here also, whenever you have to do multiple works at a time as a part of application, at a time we can make use of our multi-threading features in Java. So at a time, the same time, we will be able to do multiple works in Java according to our requirements. Okay, next thing is here. High performance through JIT compiler. What is JIT compiler? Just in time compiler. How it works, I'll explain you. Okay. See now here. Platform independency. See here, we are giving our Java program. The file extension of Java program is file.java, right? So once you are done with our Java, see, once you create our Java program, you give file extension as file.java. See now here, once you compile our Java program, internally it gives you .class file. What is this .class file? It gives us a .class file. See now here. So see, once you compile a Java program, it gives you .class file. .class file is what called as bytecode. This .class file is called as bytecode. Okay. Excuse me. So we can say it as a bytecode. Okay. We call it as a bytecode. See, it is bytecode. Okay. So once you compile a Java program, what is compilation of Java program? Simply here, we write our Java program in the form in English language, English like language. Okay. So where we can easily understand what is what and what is not, but our computer cannot understand what is what and what is not. Okay. So now here we go for compiler. Okay. What is role of compiler here? Our compiler will translate our .java program into bytecode. What is .java? It is a Java program. What is a program? A program contains a set of instructions given to a computer. See, let's say here we have an assistant. So it will be saying, right, do that work, do this work. So example, in our personal assistant, in our mobile, we may give, we have reminders, or we may give some other instructions to our mobile, right, to do so and so works, right. In the same way here also, we can give instructions to our computer. So with the help of a program, so whatever instructions you are given, all those instructions will be performed by our computer. Understand? So see now here, .class file, we call it as a bytecode. What is bytecode? Bytecode is common to all the operating systems. So we may be using operating system as Java, Windows, maybe Windows, maybe Linux, maybe whatever the operating system we use, without bothering about that operating system directly, we can do like this. Okay, so we call it as bytecode. Okay, so once we're done with this here, we give it to JVM. What is JVM? Java Virtual Machine. See, while you are trying to download our Java software, it will ask you whether to download with the for Windows or Mac or Linux, so on. It asks you, I specify multiple versions of operating system. Okay, so we can specify according to our requirements. Okay, coming to our JVM, Java Virtual Machine, it differs from one operating system to any other operating system. Understand? So, see now here, at the time of Java software installation itself, while we try to download, it will ask you what is our operating system. Based upon the operating system we have, it gives you respective JVM. So, JVM stands for Java Virtual Machine. Understand? And simply now here, now with the help of this JVM, what are we doing now? So, what are the bytecode we have? See, this bytecode is common to everything. Okay, this bytecode will be remain common for any kind of operating system. It may be anything. It may be Windows, Linux, Linux, Mac, whatever the operating system we have. But our bytecode will remain same for any kind of operating system. But coming to here, this JVM, this Java Virtual Machine, will be separate from each and every operating system. This JVM, Java Virtual Machine, is separate for each and every operating system. Understand? So, see now here. So, what is work of JVM here? Already we have compiled through Java compiler. Once again, what is role of this JVM? Java Virtual Machine. What are the bytecode we have? This bytecode will be translated into machine code. Understand? So, while it is translating our bytecode into machine code, see, this machine code may be different from one operating system to another operating system. Bytecode will remain same for all the operating systems we have. But coming to machine code will be different from one operating system to another operating system. So, here once we try to compile a Java program in the same way, what happens now?
Yes.
Automatically, it will translate our bytecode into machine code. Okay. So, see now here, our JVM will be able to take up bytecode and it will be translating into machine code. How it does here? Simply here, our JVM will read line by line of code. See, internally JVM will make use of interpreter as well as compiler. So whenever we have single line, whenever we are having general code, our JVM will pick up a line by line of code and it will translate a line by line of code from machine code into from bytecode into machine code. In the same way here, our JVM, whenever we are using the same code again and again repeatedly, let's say here we are trying to iterate a loop, or whenever we are trying to execute the same common set of code again and again permanently, in those cases, what is the better way we have? Right? Simply here now, Java Virtual Machine will make use of compiler. Whenever you have to execute the same block of code again and again multiple times, it will make use of compiler. If at all we are going to spend only a little time, let's say here, let's say this code is not there in any loop, so we need not execute the code for multiple times at a time. We can say that here, internally our JVM will make use of interpreter. It will make use of interpreter. So interpreter will copy a line by line of code and translates it into machine code. Okay, that's the way how it works. So once machine code is generated, it will be given to hardware and we get the desired results. Yes. Yeah, is this clear to you all, everybody?
Yes.
If any queries, please feel free to ask me.
I have a query.
Yeah, please.
What is the difference between JVM and interpreter?
JVM contains interpreter. JVM contains JIT compiler.
Okay.
JVM will take care of all those things. What is the role of JVM here? JVM stands for Java Virtual Machine. Its role is to read bytecode. Bytecode is common to all the operating systems. It may be Java, it may be Windows, Linux, Linux, Mac. Whatever the OS we have, our bytecode is common for all the operating systems. But here, this JVM will read this bytecode and translates it to machine code. So here our machine code will be different from one operating system to another operating system. So it may be, so for each and every operating system, it will have its own machine code. So the work of JVM is to translate bytecode into machine code. So while it is translating bytecode into machine code, Internally, it will make use of compiler as well as interpreter. If a line of code is not need to be executed again and again repeatedly, then it goes. It will make use of interpreter. If at all there is some code where you need to execute again and again repeatedly, in those cases, better be make use, internally it will make use of JIT compiler, stands for just in time compiler. So we can have high performance of the application.
Okay.
Is it clear?
So what happens when a file converts from .java to .class? It gets compiled, right?
Yeah.
So which compiler does that?
Are we going through direct compilation?
Okay.
So it will be common. Our Java compiler is common. Whatever the operating system we use, our Java compiler will be common. But whenever we are trying to execute the application here, literally it will be translated into machine code. Whatever the bytecode we have, the same bytecode will be copied into machine code. Okay.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Right. Welcome. Yeah. Any queries? Any of you? And Boj, Rujit, Zik, Sandeep. If any of you have any queries, please feel free to ask me now.
Yeah, hello, Prasad.
Yeah, please. Yeah. Yeah, Boj.
Yeah, this is Boj. Got a question for you. Do you guys use, what kind of tool you use to write Java program? Do you use Eclipse?
Yeah.
Spring Suite tools? What do you recommend?
We use Eclipse. We have lots of other editors as well. But majority of what we make use of Eclipse IDE.
Which one you guys do in your training?
Eclipse.
Eclipse, right?
Yeah.
Then, okay. So, can you tell me one difference between Java, JE, J2EE, those enterprise level? What are those things that confuses me?
Can you come again, please?
You know, we have J2EE, Java SE, those standard edition, whatever they call it.
Java so standard edition.
Mm-hmm.
JSE. Java standard edition. It is based for everything in Java, right? And JEE, Java Enterprise Edition. Here to develop general all any real time applications, we make use of JEE, which is built based upon our JSE. And to learn JSE, to learn JEE or JME. JME is Java Mobile Edition. That is separate. Okay. So whatever it is, to learn anything in Java, basic is JSE. Java Standard Edition. Okay.
So that's the basic of the Java, right? It won't go to the enterprise level. So if you want to write enterprise application with the web base using MVC, which tool we should use?
We can use same Eclipse IDE.
Eclipse with Eclipse. There is a plugin. Is there any plugin on Eclipse?
Come again? Is there any?
Is there any plugin or it's already full IDE?
Yeah, here Eclipse IDE stands for Integrated Development Environment. Okay, so everything will be given by IDE, nothing to worry. Yeah, we'll be having a chance to integrate with any servers, maybe web server or app server, anything, whatever you want to get integrated, we can do, nothing to worry. Okay,
so what kind of what are the web servers this gonna use?
Yeah, we use Tomcat, we use App Server, WebLogic.
So there is something called Java for mobile also?
Yes.
Mobile devices?
Yes, that is for mobile edition, that is separate.
That is separate.
Yeah.
So you guys gonna go through I was looking into the syllabus, and the syllabus has like basics in Java, then classes, and then do you guys go over at the enterprise level training or not?
Yes.
Because those are just the basic object oriented classes.
Yeah.
You got control flow.
Basics, we can't learn anything, right?
So after that one, what next?
Well, once we are done with this, we go for advanced Java programming part, where we go for Servlet, JSP, JDBC.
Do you guys gonna go MVC pattern in this class or not?
Once you are done with this, once you are done with Core Java, as a part of Advanced Java, we see working with servlet and JSP. Okay, and once you are done with here, we can go for MVC flow. In the same way here, we discuss like Struts framework. There we see it's a pure MVC based framework. Okay, it's a pure MVC framework. So there we see majority of part. Okay.
And then what is the database you guys going to use in the backend?
Yeah, we use MySQL, we use Oracle. Regularly we'll be using Oracle as well as MySQL.
Oracle or MySQL?
Yeah. Or both sometimes.
Okay. So do we do any live project or just like regular training and done?
If you are interested, we make you to work, okay? We give you work and we make you to work.
Oh, okay. Because the reason I asked those is I was going through the C# training and then suddenly companies moving, our company got bought and other company uses Java now. So that's the reason I'm here. I know the little bit basic of programming, but not like smart as you guys. Uh-huh.
Only thing is you need to learn carefully and you need to practice every day.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Thank
you. Any queries from any of you people? Yeah. And Gurjeet, Zip, Sandeep, any queries from your end? Right. If no queries, then I'll end the session for now.
Thank you.
And thank you all. Have a nice time.
Thank you.
Why am I not closing this again?
So many of our students have given testimonials on how our training programs are. You will find them on kudzu.com and on our website h2kinfosys.com. On our website h2kinfosys.com, you will also find more detailed information on who we are, the courses that we offer, what each course covers. Also, if you're interested in a demo program, please register on our homepage on the left-hand side. Just give us more information about yourself and we will send you a link for a demo class. The demo class is absolutely free. Experience our commitment by just attending an orientation workshop at no cost. Our team of faculty and advisors are here to guide you with the right information. If you still have more questions, please feel free to call us. Call us at 770-777-1269. This is a United States number. If you're calling from the UK, call us at 020-337-17615. You can also email us at training@h2kinfosys.com or h2kinfosys@gmail.com. Thank you for watching our videos. We wish you a great career in information technology.